96, I believe, it was adopted in 92, revised in 96.
And I want to make sure I'm on the same page too, if I may. We have a brief policy, and then that references the recommendations, which are the more lengthy, explanatory, this is how we do it type of thing. So there's two different documents, and the recommendations are probably the more living and breathing document that they're going to be reviewing.
That's correct. The general policy kind of states the non-negotiables, and the follow-up and recommendations give more day-to-day operations of what homework really looks like.
And both of those will be in handbooks.
My question on that is, we've been reviewing handbooks, teacher handbooks, so if this is our first reading, our second reading won't happen until the end of June, so will we just put a flyer in that handbook for parents and teachers?
We're working right now to find out when we have to have those handbooks really ready for print, and so we're kind of working at a calendar. Either we'll get, if the board approves this, we'll get this language in those for print, or if the board doesn't approve this, we'll stay with the old language for print, or if we're not going to be able to make the timeline work with when the decision's made, we'll probably take out of the handbook the section on homework, and we'll just put in there that an addendum will be provided, and that way we can print that addendum, and we don't create confusion as to which one is the current policy. So
the two books I looked at, one was the whole in red that you have here, and the other one like 3-4 lines, so it might be more, that makes sense. So they're going with what they went with in the past.
Right. And the secondary schools don't train handbooks, they're visual, so they'll be easy to adapt to.
The elementary and the intermediate handbooks haven't been printed yet. What you saw was a part that Gertrude Walker adds to the elementary handbook, so that will be added as part of that.
Okay. I think I did Bernadine Sitz and Georgia Matthews, I think.
Yeah, you may approve. You may be looking at some,
but
we don't have all the list approved yet.
I wondered about that. We were looking through those, and then I saw on the consent agenda we had a list that we just passed. So, okay, that makes sense. Thank you.
Any other discussion? Questions? This is our first.
Right. Yep, so we're not asking for any action. We will either put this on the consent agenda at the next, the July 29th meeting, because it's or July, June 29th meeting, because it's a short one, or at the June 10th meeting.
July
10th, sorry.
Is it summer, Dr. Carl?
Yeah, it's. If it's not, it should be.
We'll move on to the strategic plan.
All right. So you should have in your packet the board, a copy of the board strategic plan. We're not going to read through every one of these, but we do have a number of them that we want to highlight. I believe there's about 31 different goals or sub-goal statements. 33. I think we felt like we made the continuous progress on 29. There were three of them that we felt like we probably didn't make all the progress we would have liked to, and then one that we didn't make progress on. So we'll certainly hit on those four, but we've also got others. So we're a little shorthanded tonight. We've got one person on a family vacation, family reunion at the lake, one that's on her way to Mexico, and so from my leadership team, and then of course Crystal's at an Illuminate conference. So
1.3 is the goal is structure and implement the multi-tiered systems of support process with fidelity in reading, mathematics, and behavior to support diverse learning needs. Progress towards that goal is that K-8 teachers continue to implement core curriculum for reading and math. Screening and progress monitoring data continues to be utilized in PLCs to determine interventions and enrichment for students. Most K-8 schools now implement a walk-to-intervention model that provides an additional 30 minutes of differentiated instruction for students. An in-district behavior specialist continues to work with schools to improve behavior supports for students. In addition, we brought a behavior expert, Randy Sprick, into the district in March to share strategies with teachers.
One point four
is to increase the rigor of curriculum for all students. The progress this year, the implementation of new programs, as an example, Engage New York, Eureka Math, Agile Minds, Empowering Writers, and Next Generation Science, has helped increase a rigorous curriculum. In addition, many schools have implemented innovative practices such as makerspaces that support problem solving and collaboration among students. Agile Minds math curriculum was implemented in the 9th grade at Garden City High School. This curriculum adoption included 5 coaching visits from an Agile Minds instructional coach. Individual goals were set with each teacher to review data and increase rigor of instruction and learning.
I'm going to cover 2.1.
I'm sorry, can I make a comment?
Yes, ma'am.
That one, I apologize.
No problem.
It's still, to me, this goal, I don't know, I mean, my kind of almost focuses on the higher end kids to a certain degree, because it seems like a lot of times those are the ones who almost get missed to a certain degree, because we have all of the federal requirements with our special education, and we've got the one-to-one initiatives with some of those kids, and we've got the class within a class, and we're dealing with all those things because of the unfunded federal mandates. But the kids who are higher end, just, and I don't know if this necessarily addresses it, this is our curriculum. And I'm glad that it's a rigorous curriculum, but it's still the standard curriculum. And I am hoping that whatever's going on probably right now as we speak in Topeka can help us get to the point where maybe, because I know we've talked about having an IB program for the high school, but doing something more so those kids who are wanting to go to college can have something a little bit more rigorous than what we're currently providing. It seems at times that those kids are just dealing with whatever it is that we've got. And I'd like to see that kind of fleshed out more sometime.
Good.
Sorry.
That's the word. Anything else on that?
Observed the 90 program in Springfield when we went down there for a conference. So we did look at it at one point.
I think it was costly.
Yeah, it was pretty expensive.
And I don't know if IB is necessarily the way to go. I mean, we do have the college classes, so the dual credit, so I think that's helpful. But, you know, I still go back even to my own personal experience where my third grader was reading at the fifth grade level, but now my fifth grader was reading in the fifth grade level, because there wasn't that push to keep them moving forward. And of course, actually, he doesn't like to read. It's all about math. But I mean, I just want us to be able, even in the lower levels, to push those kids who may not qualify as gifted even, to be a little bit more rigorous, and so they're progressing and not just being stagnant.
But that's something that programs, not necessarily at you, but other ones that we can participate in and to accomplish the same again, but not have the same type of expense or whatever.
will talk about 2.1. The goal is to increase the number of percentage of teachers who hold license endorsements in English for speakers of other languages and special education. We've made continuous progress with this goal. We have 268 ESOL endorsed teachers that have endorsements. There were 11 that were on the plan of study, which we also get to count even though they're not complete. Two additional teachers have taken senior summer classes or testing, which enabled them to be certified to teach at our early childhood center. And we have 8 teachers that have continued on a waiver working towards SPED degrees. I think through some of our presentations and recruiting and always maybe struggling to find special education teachers, that's kind of an example of getting teachers that might be licensed in a different area perhaps, and we've convinced them to take a special education position, and they do so under that waiver. So we're continuing to make progress in each of those areas. Questions?
Mr. Hill, when did we implement the extra pay for the endorsement? Because I see that there's a big jump from the 09-10 year to the 10-11 year.
I don't think it was that far back. I think it was only maybe 2 years ago, or at the most 3 years ago, when we offered, what Ms. Borges was asking about is we offer an incentive for teachers, any teacher that is ESO endorsed, or they get it added to their license prior to September 1, then we give them a $1,000 bonus. Back when we started that, it was before the block grant funding, and so we were still getting additional monies from the state based on the number of teachers, and of course being able to count minutes since block grant funding, we've not been able to do that, but we still feel like that's an important skill to have, good teaching strategies for all kids, and so we still continue to do that incentive. 2.2, increase the number and percentage of highly qualified teaching staff in the district. The board is very familiar with the difficulty it is that we've been having to recruit teachers. It's increased across the nation. The impact is significantly impacting Garden City, as we've seen the number of unfilled positions continuing to increase. We continually work to establish our Grow Your Own program and renewed partnerships with universities. Although it's not a long-term solution to the shortage, we have been seen a great benefit with our student teaching incentive and the number of positions we have been able to fill. We have increased our efforts with our traditional recruiting methods, attending more career fairs than we have in our documented history. Additionally, we continue to advertise and promote our employee referral program that's funded by an outside donor. To date, we're ahead of where we were a year ago. We've currently hired 46, actually today it's 47, compared to 43 during our season last year. Not only have we increased our efforts in our recruiting, but we also have begun to study retention. A committee was formed to find out what's important to teachers and to make Garden City the best place to work. We have still listed this as limited progress, just based on the ultimate goal is to increase, but we do feel like we are making strides to continue to address that problem.
Garden City Leadership Academy met Friday, that Thursday in Dodge, I think, and Friday's here. And the Director of Human Resources for the Salina District came as one of the instructors, facilitators of the group. And she and I talked, and she said, we're feeling this. She said, this is the first time in Salina we do not have a pool for our elementary candidates. So we continue to see this problem shifting and working its way across the state. So I truly believe that these non-traditional methods, the grow your own kind of things, the student teaching program incentives, those things are really critical for us to address this, because if we wait for other people to solve this shortage for us, we will have some really tough times. Although we're not where we want to be, I agree with Mr. Hogan, we are making progress. And hopefully this year we'll be in a better position.
students participated in the high school graduation ceremony on May 13th. 56 students graduated from an alternative center, with additional students expected to meet the requirements prior to the September 30th deadline set forth by the state. Garden City will again exceed over 100 graduates for the second consecutive year. So we're saying that we have continuous progress made there.
I have kind of a tangential question on that, and I'm not sure if it's one of our goals specifically, but it's kind of along those lines. Have we been looking at our truancy rate?
One of the things that graduation rate is one of the state outcomes, along with it is post-secondary attendance and completion. Now, we've got some preliminary information from the State Department on that. That's something they're going to use the National Student Clearinghouse to measure. We'll report on that to the board in July, and I think we have some really great information to be able to share with you. I think you'll see that our percentage of students first time attending college actually exceeds the state average, and that's really great news. And I shouldn't say college, it's really post-secondary, so it could be attending a trade school, it could be attending college. There's also some other data that they're going to factor, statistically adjust for certain risk factors, things like cumulative poverty, things like chronic absenteeism, there's five or six different risk factors. But when they do that, Garden City comes out above the state average. And while we'd love to be number one, we're happy to be above the state average. That gives us a good place to start and begin to grow from. So two really big outcomes that the State Department is looking at: graduation rate and that post-secondary attendance and completion, and we feel like we've got good news to report in both those areas.
But the Senate Bill 316, we need to add currency to our list of our strategic plan.
Sure, that's something we, and what's interesting with those risk factors, there's two of them that really I think we can address. One,
I couldn't get a question.
Senate Bill 367, which was adopted not this last legislative session, obviously the one before, is the one that overhauls the juvenile justice system, and they're looking at truancy as one of the things, and that was one of the memorandums of understanding that we were supposed to work at one point with the county attorney's office. So I was thinking maybe we needed to address that with our strategic plan as well to kind of go along with that.
We certainly can. Two of those risk factors, one is chronic absenteeism and one is, I believe, percentage of new teachers. Those are probably the only two of the five or six that we can actually address and have an impact. The others are things like cumulative poverty, which as a school, we can't have a whole lot of impact on how our families that are customers are coming us from, but the truancy, that absenteeism is a piece that we can do some things there to have an impact on that. So
the percentage of new teachers that you mentioned, is that supposed to be some indication of learning environment, or what is that? Why would they measure that?
Because that may have an impact on the ability of kids to be successful. A veteran teacher may be more skilled than a brand new teacher is the theory there.
At one time we had talked about the percentage rate, the 89.6% is being maybe not as clear, because it would include students that we just simply don't know where they went. They could be enrolled in school but graduated. What is the criteria for arriving at that?
The 89.6 is a four-year cohort number. We have some kids that will graduate in 5 years. those state outcomes are gonna become very important. And right now, we're doing pretty well in terms of the graduation rate, the way they would like us to measure it. But that additional information may be more evidence to be able to show that not only are we doing pretty well here, we're doing even better when we look at that five-year.
I like the fact that we're measuring success for ourselves.
Okay, goal 3.2 is provide continuous job and benefit professional development and individualized feedback for teachers and administrators. Progress for this year, literacy, math coaches, and lead teachers were utilized in K-6 buildings this year to support teachers in reading and math curriculum and pedagogy. In addition, these content specialists were utilized to support instructional growth and development through PLCs. 34 teachers who attended last summer's ITQ math grant were coached throughout the year by outside math consultants. Ninth grade math teachers were provided job embedded coaching through the Agile Mind consultants. District-wide professional development was redesigned this year to include more individualized professional development for teachers. The Professional Development Council was repurposed to provide greater attention to professional learning of teachers. The year began with Eric Scheninger, a national speaker from the International Center of Leadership and Education, discussing personal learning networks and how to set up a PLN. Personalized learning was the focus in March when teachers participated in an EdCamp experience. So we feel like continuous progress was being done. Any questions about that? Okay, goal 3.3 is to utilize classroom walkthrough data to create a feedback loop which informs professional development priorities. We feel like we made limited progress this year, because consistent walkthroughs did not occur in all classrooms during the 2016-2017 school year. Principals, instructional coaches, and university supervisors working with new and student teachers utilized the e-walkthrough tool developed by Southwest Plains Regional Service Center. This year, the district will work with Southwest Plains to develop a walkthrough tool that can be used by district staff that can be used to inform professional development. It will be easy to use and will give great feedback.
3.4, develop ongoing professional relationships with leading thinkers, researchers, and practitioners in the profession. We continue our partnership with ICLE, one of their main people, Eric Scheninger, worked with the district and was part of our kickoff at the back to school last August. We also, the high school completed a digital practices assessment through ICLE. And that information will be used to help them make some decisions about what they do with iPads and the training and what they do at the high school. The district hosted professional development activities in math with John Sangiovanni in both the fall and the spring, and Randy Sprigg, the developer of the CHAMPS program and author, worked with our staff in the spring on relationships and classroom management strategies. Questions on that one? 4.1, provide ongoing recognition of student, staff, and district level achievements. We continue to do a lot of things like what we did tonight at the board, recognizing students at meetings, news releases to media for articles. We get very good coverage using the district website. We have a weekly newsletter, electronic newsletter that goes out to staff. We do have a social media presence, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. And then we also sometimes get the city commission involved in some of our recognitions. Guard City High School started a Teacher of the Month recognition program. We also recognize employees' contributions at the end of the year staff appreciation event. This year that was a dinner due to the calendar. We also changed the menu a little bit and tried to shorten the program, which we were pretty successful in. We've been going to almost 2.5 hours, and I think we were down to about 1 hour and 20 minutes, and some of our past feedback was that was discouraging some attendance, so hopefully some of those changes will help get more staff members involved in recognizing their colleagues. So questions about that one? 4.3, expand communication between home and school, including automated services, PBS, television, KBBS radio, Sugar Beet local radio stations, social media, iPad, the internet. Again, here we felt like we didn't make progress. We launched an updated website this year with more up-to-date content. A district-specific app has also been developed and put into operation to provide convenient individualized access to district information for stakeholders. So if you haven't downloaded that app on your phone, you ought to try it. Garden City High School continues to operate the only high school radio station in Kansas, in part to provide information to the community. We have weekly news updates and with information about district events, happenings, and recognitions that are aired on the radio station. BBS system continues to put information out, and they they've done more programming this year and earned more awards than in the past. And we have our school site councils formed and meeting regularly. I think doing a better job of that than what we've done in the past. We also are in the process of kind of structuring the groups for the new accreditation system, and that will include a district site council, which is being put together and will meet at least twice a year.
What's the app?
GC. Because if you go to the App Store, Garden City PS, I think it is. So if you type in Garden City PS, it's for public school.
What's it called? Garden City what? PS?
Yeah, Garden City PS.
So the goal is 5.1, develop a system to measure and evaluate parent involvement in schools. When I took this goal on 3 years ago, I had no idea the time commitment that it was going to take to deal with our current teacher shortage. So I spend the majority of my time doing that, and therefore the focus has been on dealing with the teacher shortage, trying to fill positions, increase recruiting, and so we have made no progress towards this goal at this time.
This was originally going to be a dissertation topic. And just quite honestly, time, it's a matter of prioritizing time, and quality teachers is outweighing what we have the manpower to do. So that's been where we put our priority.
Is there something though that, because even on our website, there's you can access every although it's much appreciated, 68 parents filling out a survey compared to the number of parents we have isn't a lot.
Right.
So that's, it's concerning. And we talk about this all the time in terms of the feedback we get. So is there something that they can at least count how many times people access these, even those resources? School, like the school, the individual school web page or ours?
I think there's a report that we can get that shows the traffic that's going to those pages that the technology people can probably generate through our internet provider for us.
Even that would be helpful, wouldn't it?
Sure. But I'll tell you, there's a lot more parent involvement than what...
Is online.
Right.
Sure.
When we look at the literacy nights, the activity at the individual schools, I think we have... We would always take more, of course, but I don't think we have a problem with parent involvement. I think we would like to see parents more involved, but we do get good participation. We have a number of buildings that get 100% participation in parent-teacher conferences. When we did the Engage New York math nights, we got good attendance at those. And quite honestly, it's typically better when it's a school-based purpose than when it's something coming from the central office, which that's probably not a surprise. Parents are willing to come and help out, get involved at their school when we ask them. But the idea here was that we would be more systematic in a way to measure and monitor that, really. And that's where we haven't been able to devote the time.
judging by the, you know, how many, you know, what, who, clicking on a website, I don't think that's a good way to grade if our parents are involved or not. I think the school can monitor that and say, we had 100% participation in, you know, parent-teacher conferences, we're doing Friday night events, we're doing after-school events, and, you know, keep track somehow, and then report.
Right, and I think all of those things would be good, good ways, good indicators. Some people will connect online, some won't. Some will want to be at every event, some will be more selective in the events. Our challenge here, just honestly, has been the matter of prioritizing time. And if it's right now recruiting teachers and methods to fill more of our classroom teaching positions has outweighed what we've had time to do. Because, folks, there's 33 different goals, sub-goals here. That's a lot. And we'll continue to go back and look at some other ways that we can make progress. But we have to rethink this one because we don't have the time to do what we originally envisioned doing.
But I do think this is should be a higher priority, maybe, because, you know, I attended a math night and I did not think it was well attended. And, you know, it's important that we're not wasting our resources on programs that aren't drawing people, or like the programs that are drawing people, what are they doing that are getting that parent response? You know, because if we don't know what is getting parents to school, we're wasting our time and resources. And I don't think that is in anybody's best interest. So to me, this is should be a high priority. I mean, we should track and we should figure out what schools have the highest parental involvement and why. And I mean, I know all of our schools are very different and you can't have a one size fits all, but if we can see what's working or what's not, I just think it is a higher priority than not than getting teachers here. I understand we can only do so many things, but I don't think it should just be plucked off, because then we're wasting time and resources. We can have all the events that we want, but if nobody's attending them, I mean, I got a lot out of that math night, so I was disappointed that there were probably only maybe 10 or 12 other people there, and I didn't even attend that school. I just went as a school board member. So, you know, that's concerning for me, because they put a lot of time and effort into that thing. They had prizes. They had several teachers there. And I mean, so I think one thing that we haven't mentioned also is Skyward. I know I realized last night I'm going through Skyward withdrawal. It's my understanding you can send messages through Skyward. So I'm sure there's other helicopter parents like me who are now going through Skyward withdrawal as well. Because I didn't know about the survey. I wouldn't have taken it since I'm on board, but that may have been one way to get that more out there as well. So I think a lot of people do look at Skyward. What homework assignments are my kids might be missing? Where are their grades? Where do we need to work? I think some of the teachers have bad days. Let's say you scored 10 out of 100. What do we need to work on? That's a 10.
I think it's important to know
just a